The next speaker is Al Pfister from Western Wildscapes. He tells us about species conservation days.
Thank you, Jonathan. Good to see a lot of you again. It's been a few years since I've been up here whole plan with y'all. But together life is good too. So I'm here to talk to you today about a tool that I guess at the end of my Fish and Wildlife Service career and since then I think has a lot of potential positive implications for, well, Gunnison sage-grouse as a host of other species throughout the western U.S. And, you know, I've worked in seven different western states dealing with sensitive and endangered species issues, and just it continually gets reinforced how valuable tool this potentially is. It has some limitations, for sure, but to me, one of the important things is that it provides an incentive for landowners that, for whatever reason, have been able to keep their habitat in good condition for the species under consideration. They can get some financial incentive, i.e. money in their pocket, to keep on managing for those species. So I'm going to try and cover that and why I believe that through the course of things here, and in the course of, or in the theme of throwing some Al Leopold thoughts up there, the father of wildlife management. But to me, the key words in there are ethically, aesthetically, and economically. So, you know, trying to combine those, I think the banking, species conservation banking, does those types of things. So, you know, there's talks of getting the economic incentive. I remember when I was working in Southern California in the early 90s, they were talking about it then, but just couldn't get the momentum behind it. Things have, so what is a conservation bank? It's either a site or a group of sites that provide habitat for a given species, and how it essentially will be the mitigation site for that given species. So, you know, even though species get dusted, you know, it doesn't mean impacts are going to be stopped. Actions continue within the endangered species habitat, and mitigation is needed. So, like for species conservation banks, right now there's the Fish and Wildlife Service guidance from 2003, and you know, the general perspective of it is that providing that conservation benefit and to offset the unavoidable impacts that are occurring somewhere within that species, what I'll define later as the service area for that given conservation bank. You've all seen slides or basically know the percentage of federal lands throughout the western U.S. and throughout the country. And just to give you a different pictorial representation of that, here's just, you know, here in the west, a lot of federal, western Colorado or western U.S., whereas eastern Colorado, a lot more private lands. But to me, that shows the value, potential value of what mitigation or species conservation banks can do for overall species conservation. In a lot of situations here in the west, private lands are really close to those public lands. So, you know, we need to be looking at the landscape level in order to conserve species, particularly ones such as sage-grouse. As far as the overall banking market is concerned, there's all sorts of banking efforts going on for all sorts of resources. They're listed there, and it's not only just in the U.S., it's an international type of scenario where this is occurring, and to me, that is what's one of the really neat aspects of it, is that it's providing that financial incentive for private land owners to help conserve species. I mean, I forget the exact percentage, but 70% of endangered species, you know, have a heavy component of private lands as part of their habitat. So there again, I just think it's critical that we provide an additional incentive for landowners to keep doing the good things that they are doing. So throw a little bit of different additional terminology, resource conservation banks. That's where essentially we'd be combining a species conservation bank with a wetland bank. And you know, when we're talking about species like sage-grouse, we're going to be looking for large chunks of land and that we're going to be conserved. So that's probably going to have a wetland component. You know, so there's a potential that that landowner could also be selling wetland mitigation credits. The wetland mitigation banking arena is, I'll say, been more refined over a longer period of time than Species Conservation Bank. There were a few of them that were started both in the early 90s, but the mitigation, wetland mitigation banking it took off significantly faster than Species Conservation Banking. So, you know, there's the opportunity to combine both and provide the landowner with some financial rewards for the efforts to do that. But as far as banking in general is concerned, you know, they did some studies for wetland mitigation banking and found out that the permittee responsible banking, i.e. it was done basically on site, there was a very high failure rate with those mitigation efforts that were done there. So with the mitigation bank, you're setting us, whether it's for species or wetlands, you're setting up a larger section of land to actually manage the landscape and provide more benefits for the resources that you're selling the credits for. And to me, here's some recent initiatives or whatever general descriptor you want to use for what's happening, and this is just in the past. Well, the first one, Secretary Order for Mitigation Policies, was 2013, but all those other ones are basically within the last 6 months, which to me is really encouraging from a banking perspective, looking at implementing mitigation at the landscape level, whether you're talking, you know, this could be used for impacts occurring on federal lands or private lands. So managing again on the landscape level. And a presidential memorandum that just came out last November talks about encouraging federal agencies to use the private sector to help accomplish all these mitigation objectives, because impacts will continue to occur as we continue to exist, live, etc. So, to me, that's, yeah, granted, it's a memorandum, it's not an order or anything like that, executive order, but to me, that's just really encouraging to show that that there's the thinking out there going on. We're working on a landscape level, but also using the private sector to do that. And one of the things I've experienced with as far as trying to get banks established is, you know, if there's really any federal funding involved, it usually that can't help or that can be counted towards what the landowner is could use as far as mitigation credits. But just last month, the NRCS announced that they had $9 million available to assist ranchers in developing wetland mitigation banks. There was the caveat that, you know, all those mitigation credits had to be used by producers, agricultural producers, but to me that's an encouraging trend that within the federal government banking could utilize, the banker could be utilizing some of those federal dollars. NRCS has a lot of different programs that help landowners enhance their land values. So that to me is really encouraging. I know I've talked with some people over the years as far as they've already implemented NRCS practices on their lands to do that. So to me that's really encouraging. And then the Fish and Wildlife Service, I didn't look in the Federal Register yesterday, I was having so much fun here to see if that was actually published, but the service put out their new mitigation policy. This is just an overall mitigation policy, and I know there's efforts within the service to give more direction for species conservation banking. And to me that's really important, because it somewhat sets a standard for how mitigation banks, whether they be species or wetlands, are developed. And if you follow the history of wetland mitigation banking, and for the first, say, almost 20 years of wetland mitigation banking, there was no planning rule, but the planning rule came out in 2008, and talking to mitigation bankers and going to the National Mitigation Banking Conference, there's a lot of, I guess, people that really like that. You know, most people don't like additional regulations, etc. But, you know, from the banking perspective, they really thought that helped them do their job so that people could know what the standard was to shoot for. So my understanding is that the Fish and Wildlife Service is working on something similar to that for species conservation banking. I know Devlin Mead from the Washington office was saying that it was going to be coming out sometime within the next year, and I don't know if somebody from the service can correct me or provide additional updates if we need to. But, you know, so what's in it for the individual banker? Here's a listing of different species and the credit or the value that they were selling their credits for. And this was in 09. It was ranged from anywhere from like $1,500 to $350,000. I have a slide later that shows that based on some more recent information, it goes from $1,500 to $650,000 per acre. And granted, you know, we're not going to be able to sell sagebrush for $650,000 an acre. And those numbers are probably from California, where land is worth more. But, you know, there again, it provides a financial incentive for landowners to provide the overall community, conservation community, and how we're conserving species. So where are we at with species conservation banking in the country right now? Right now, there's approximately 112, depending on how you count the numbers. Some people compile numbers with banks that have already sold all their credits, but there's 112 active banks right now. As you can see, the vast majority of them are in California. And there's a few other states that have a few. Colorado has one, it's for Preble's meadow jumping mouse. There have been two banks done for greater sage-grouse, one in Nevada and one in Wyoming. Another grouse species, there's been one done for lesser prairie chicken. I don't know what the value of the credits they're selling there for. I'm talking to some folks from Wyoming. I guess they haven't sold any credits yet. They're kind of working on that. You need to get the mitigation formulas, et cetera, worked out as part of that whole scenario. But some of the challenges to establishing a bank is, for one, having a willing landowner. You know, a lot of times landowners are land rich, but actual financial resources limited. So, you know, I guess as a general guesstimate, I use it throughout the figure of anywhere from 100,000 to 400,000 to need it to establish a bank, and that includes doing all the legal research for mineral rights, etc. Going through that a little bit more on the next slide. But then also the market demand. So if a landowner goes through all the effort of establishing this bank, are they really going to be able to sell those types of things? So those are considerations for that, and in some ways a big challenge. And sometimes there's the consideration of, like, the ones that were done for greater sage-grouse, are those really going to be used? Those were done when the listing decision was still pending. So it'll be interesting to see how those are used, et cetera. I mean, I think it's a great thing. I mean, you could technically, or, you know, when the service is evaluating a species for whether to be listed or not, if there's banks established for a given species, those banks are protected in perpetuity for that given species. So that would be another thing to potentially preclude the need to list a given species. So these are the various considerations. Don't pay attention to all the different colors and all that. I was just having fun one night, I guess. But you know, the service area there is an important consideration as to where the banker can sell those credits. So in terms of just talking Gunnison sage-grouse, so if a bank was established here in the Gunnison Basin, would the service area be just the Gunnison Basin, or would it be range-wide? Those are the types of discussions would have to take place with the service and the landowners, et cetera, involved to make that. And, you know, if, when they do, But the service area is the area where the bank sponsor, the landowner, can get to sell their credits. To give you somewhat of another analogy for wetlands, it's usually like, say, a river drainage. But it's not, if you have a wetland bank in the Colorado River, it's not for the entire river. It'll be a smaller subset hydrological unit within that. So, but these are all the different types of things that will happen in bank establishment. Okay, there's just numbers as far as overall species or wetland banks versus species banks. There again, the considerations and how you're going to determine those credits. That's a big challenge for species like the sage-grouse, whether it be Gunnison or greater. So I guess my time's up. And I don't know if we have time for questions.
Do you have a question?
Is it always a landowner that starts the bank, or sometimes is it a group like WAFLA, or?
It can be. I mean, there's no, I wouldn't say there's exactly a set rule. It's one of the bigger challenges I mentioned was having the money to provide that upfront cost to develop how that land is going to be managed, determine what the needs are, what the ecological lift within that given piece of property is needed to be, et cetera. So that, you know, you could have found a willing landowner, but then you found some other entity that is willing to fund that, then you could have, do that combination of things to get a bank established for the species conservation.
Maybe one more? All right, thanks.